Good morning. My name is Jerry Hubbard. I'm one of the pastors here. I'd like to begin with a scripture. Psalm 116, verse 15 says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of one of his saints." Amen. A couple of housekeeping things before we get started with this important service for Pastor Ron. I want to remind you, if you would, out of honor to the family, to please silence your cell phones at this time. If you need assistance during the service, any one of the ushers who have badges on will be able to help you. We've also got several medical professionals that are here today to assist in the event of a crisis. Some of you have not been able to greet the family yet, and if so, I want to encourage you, there will be plenty of opportunity after the service today. As we begin this morning, I'd like to pray and welcome the Lord here. Would you bow your heads and hearts with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity, and we thank you that for the Christian, death is not a wall, that it's a door. Lord, we ask your blessing on this time, and we thank you that whoever believes and lives in you will never die. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask Ashley and our worship team to come forward at this time to lead us in one of Pastor Ron's favorite songs. If you're able, please stand, but please don't feel compelled to do that.
Thousand years and then forever. Good morning, family. And all who enter this church are family. That is our church here. God bless each one of you for being here to honor Pastor Ron. My name is Norman Hong. For those who don't know me, I'm chairman of the Board of Elders of Kaimuki Christian Church and School. And I was deeply honored to be asked by Dee and Rocky and the Arnold family to deliver the eulogy for Pastor Ron, and I really am honored to do that. They spent a lot of time putting it together, and I know it was pretty difficult, but I'm sure it brought back wonderful memories of Ron's life. So let me present this. Ron Arnold lived a full life that was defined by his love for the Lord, his love for his family, especially his wife Dee, his church family, and any other person he had 30 seconds to befriend. Ron was a kind but powerful man and longed for each and every person to know of the saving grace that changed his life. Ronald Allen Arnold, who we lovingly know as just Ron, was born on July 27, 1950, to Gerald and Virginia Arnold. He was raised on a farm outside of Trumbull, Nebraska, where he enjoyed baseball, Boy Scouts, 4-H, and fishing. He helped on the family farm with the livestock, cows, pigs, and sheep. But after shearing sheep, he said, there had to be a better way to make a living. He grew up with two older brothers, Jerry and David. Jerry's here with us today, Jerry. A younger sister, Beverly, and a younger brother, Joseph. Ron spent his childhood trying to keep up with his brothers, often being led into mischief by his older brother, Dave, or his best friends, Jerry Beach and Linton Black. Ron's older brother, Jerry, throughout the years has often said, Ron is my little brother, but I've always looked up to him. Ron excelled at football in high school until he suffered a career-ending knee injury his senior year. Ron's coach once said that he was the best all-around offensive guard he had ever coached. Ron accepted Jesus into his heart at the age of 10, but later admitted that he drifted away from the Lord during his early college years. Ron's mother, Ginny, knew the Lord had a special plan for him early in his life. While playing behind the family stove as an infant, he inhaled kerosene from a toy he had soaked in the field. Panicked, Ron's mom and dad rushed him to the hospital 15 miles away as his mother pounded on his back, which ended up saving his life. Ron's parents gave all the glory to God for that day, and it was then they knew that God had something special in store for him, and we know that. Ron graduated from Trumbull High School in 1968 and attended Kearney State College, where he majored in motorcycle riding and majored in Deanna Pavlik, a beautiful farm girl from Northeast Nebraska. Ron and Dee married in the spring of 1970 and soon committed their lives completely to the Lord. Ron spent the first 4 years of their marriage working in construction and selling stainless steel cookware to the hungry and unsuspecting people of Nebraska. Well on his way to becoming a successful salesman, his mentor, Pastor Leroy Herder, asked him to consider going into full-time ministry and join him as an associate pastor in Salt Lake City, Utah. After much prayer, Ron and Dee moved to Utah the summer of 1974. Their 5 years in Utah proved to be fruitful as their son Lance was adopted on November 25th, 1974, and Rocky was born on November 25th, 1975. There's something about that date, I guess, huh? Ron continued to listen to the Lord's leading, and thankfully, the Lord called him out of Salt Lake City to Honolulu in the summer of 1979. Pastor Harold Gallagher had asked him to be associate pastor of Kaimuki Christian Church, Ron and the family moved to Honolulu, where Ron quickly fell in love with the people and the culture of Hawaii. Ron was an associate pastor of KCC from 1979 to 1983, when the church commissioned him to plant a new church in East Honolulu. It was during this time that he reached out to a Vietnamese family that was new to the island at a park in East Oahu. Through this encounter, Touch Yuen became a believer. Touch is, I believe, sitting right there. And started a Vietnamese church at KCC, which still meets today. Ron planted Hawaii Kai Christian Church in 1983, a series of house churches that eventually grew into a flourishing congregation meeting weekly at Kaiser High School. Ron studied in the evenings and received both his bachelor and master's degrees from International College and Graduate School of Theology in Honolulu. His uncle Eldon, whose daughter Leanne is here today, moved to Hawaii and took a pastoral position at the church, where he and Ron enjoyed ministering, fishing, and golfing side by side. Ron was actively involved in Lance and Rocky's lives as a soccer coach and Boy Scout leader, to name a few. Wanting to live in the Northwest as well as provide their children a different perspective, the Arnolds moved to Klamath Falls, Oregon in 1989. Ron became the pastor of Shastaway Christian Church, where he succeeded a pastor of 32 years. I know there are some folks from Klamath Falls here visiting specifically for this. So thank you for making that long journey. Ron enjoyed the lifestyle of this Northwest logging town, especially the surrounding forests and the abundant trout fishing. He knew Ron was into fishing. While in Oregon, KCC's head elder, Gene Smith, called Ron to inform him that after 32 years, Harold Gallagher had announced his retirement. Gene requested that Ron submit his resume for the position, and he was invited to become KCC's new senior pastor. They moved back to Hawaii in 1993, and Ron often remarked how the Lord had orchestrated his ministry path from Nebraska to Utah to Hawaii and then Oregon to prepare him to serve at Kaimuki Christian Church. Ron has been senior pastor at KCC for 25 years. His love for people and vision to further the gospel has fueled his ministry to make a difference in Hawaii and to the ends of the earth. Ron saw Kaimuki Christian as a place that would equip men and women, both young and old, to learn about the Lord, invest deeply in their personal relationship, and then tell others about their changed lives. Ron pursued this vision with constant support and friendship of Pastor Cal Takara, Pastor Jerry Hubbard, Tim and Linnell Mathery, who have faithfully served with Ron for decades. In more recent years, Pastors Nofo and Marie Elatise, Liana Yamauchi, Valerie Sanders, Pastor Danny Hahn, and Ashley Haler have been essential in partnering with Ron in his vision for KCC. Thank you for all of you. In order to accommodate the vision and growing numbers, the worship center was doubled in with the help of his good friend, architect, and elder, Norman Hong. It's just happens to be me. This vision also led the church and school to buy adjacent properties on the block in order to expand the school from an elementary school to the flourishing high school it is today. This was accomplished alongside recently retired principal Mark Gallagher, who's sitting here, Mark, and current principal Robin Ahn. Robin's somewhere in here. His love for the Lord and others led him to partner with Common Grace, founded by his close and longtime friend Jay Jarman, who we'll hear from a little later. The Hawaii Family Forum, the Kaimuki Business and Professionals Association, and Compassion International. Ron's passion to spread the good news to the ends of the earth led him on numerous mission trips where he would minister to people in the Holy Land, Nicaragua, Africa, the Philippines, Samoa, Thailand, and Kazakhstan. Ron loved his family. He and Dee enjoyed visiting their extended family in Nebraska through the years. He had a deep love for his parents, who were such a beloved patriarch and matriarch to all the Arnolds. Ron's dad is now 91 and couldn't fly to be here. And sadly, his mom, Virginia, passed away in 2012. He enjoyed visiting his kids and grandkids on the mainland. Lance, Eileen, Colt and Callie in Nebraska, as well as Rocky and Adara, Brooks and Weston in Nashville. Yeah. Ron's adventurous spirit created countless memories for his grandkids, including fishing, camping, traveling, and even Disneyland. Colt appreciates how Grandpa enjoyed coming alongside him in his own hobbies and experiences. Callie loves Grandpa's sense of humor and how he taught her to play golf. Brooks loved that Grandpa told him he could do anything he wanted in his life and said Grandpa showed him this by golfing, fishing, and taking care of others, even after having been diagnosed with cancer. Weston was a constant prayer warrior for Grandpa. He would open every prayer, Jesus, name of God, please pray that Grandpa heals, often said with a hand gently placed on Grandpa. Ron was passionate about his hobbies. Like every other native Nebraskan, he loved watching Husker football above all. In addition to college football, he enjoyed the Golf Channel, the Green Bay Packers, and the University of Hawaii baseball with coach Mike Trapasso, who is here. Ron has owned motorcycles throughout his life and has enjoyed exploring the mainland and the island, most recently with his good friend Robert Jackson. Ron was very active, exercising 5 days a week and playing golf as often as he could get out. In fact, Ron played Fort Shafter Golf Course every Thursday for the past 24 years. A consistent group of KCC golfers tee off at 1 o'clock every Thursday afternoon. But Ron would be the first to tell you it's not about the golf, it's about the people. Ron's faith and life have been anchored by his personal relationship with the Lord. Since committing his life to the Lord in college, Ron has spent every morning in quiet time and has filled countless journals with his reflections. He credits this relationship to giving him the strength and knowledge for anything he may have accomplished. Even to his dying day, he admitted that he was flawed, and only by God's grace has he been able to make any impact at all. It is most likely that each of you who are at this service today are at this service today because Ron has touched your life. He loved you, and you felt that. He was genuinely interested in you and your story. Equally important, he was very appreciative for all that you, the church family, has done for him and Dee all these years. During the past few weeks, Dee has received countless notes from people telling of the impact Ron has made on their lives. Here are a few of those sentiments. Through these 25 years, you have not only been our senior pastor and leader of KCC, but also a dear friend. Another one, this year, through your trials of life's challenges, you have taught me so much about living as a Christian. Thank you so much for your loving kindness in spite of difficult circumstances. You have a gift of being able to explain touchy subjects with such humility that sin is called sin, and yet God's love and your love for the sinner always comes through. And another one. Until we also reach our heavenly reward, we will miss Ron's unspoken sermons, his quick humor, vast knowledge, helpful advice, and his devoted presence. Ron was diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer in December 3rd, 2017, just about a year ago. Throughout the biggest fight of his life, he continually put the needs of Dee, his family, and the church family above his own. He made it a priority to watch every sunset with Dee. He would graciously entertain visitors and twice travel to Nebraska to attend his 50th high school reunion and visit his father, Gerald, and the rest of his family. One big highlight was a fishing trip to Alaska with Rocky and his brother, Jerry, whom he had always admired. Ron attended as many KCC services as his body allowed, faithfully wrote his articles for the Kanalu, and worked alongside the elders to secure his vision and the future of Kaimuki Christian. Ron was delighted to be here to see Brian Sands become KCC's new lead pastor. Ron passed away peacefully in the morning of November 12th at St. Francis Hospice. Dee and Rocky were by his side, saying prayers, telling stories, singing and playing hymns. The song Jesus Paid It All was playing as Ron's final breath passed his lips. Here's a verse that followed his breath. And when before the throne I stand in incomplete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall repeat. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. In closing, to our church family, let's continue Ron's legacy, the legacy he had of his vision for the church, but also to reach out and love one another, reach out to the community and to the ends of the earth. To Dee, Lance, Rocky, and the Arnold family, thank you for sharing Ron with us all these years. We really appreciate all that you have done. And to our dear brother, Ron, we just thank you for the impact you've made on our lives. We know you're now in heaven. We rejoice, although we're sad, that now you're in heaven in the arms of the Lord, free from pain. And we know that the Lord's words to Ron when he entered the presence of the Lord was, well done, good and faithful servant. Welcome home.
What a Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of life and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save.
I think you would all agree with me that Ron ran and finished his race well. As Norman mentioned, I served alongside Pastor Ron for 25 years as his associate, as one of his associates. Tons of stories over the years, but he was such a man of adventure that he would take risks that few people would take. Give you one example. This has happened some years ago. I came across a blonde joke. And I dared Pastor Ron to use it in one of his sermons. I was flabbergasted as I sat in the pews and heard the joke being told, and I said, I can't believe he's telling this joke. He was one of a man of adventure. I am one of hundreds of lives that Ron touched through the years. He reached out to me as a reluctant and guarded seeker and led me to Christ 38 years ago and changed. The course of my life. I can't imagine what my life would have been if I had not met Ron. I think many of you would say the same thing. When Dee, Rocky, and Anna Darrow started planning for this celebration service and thought about what they wanted to have shared about Ron, two themes emerged as they reflected on his life. One was vision, and the other grace. I get to share the vision part, and his dear friend Jay will come up shortly and share the grace part. Some of you might associate Pastor Ron with his vision for discipleship and his passion for the Great Commission to make disciples who love God passionately and their neighbor as themselves, a vision that has been posted on this banner for the past 8 years. A vision that was refined through a number of versions and iterations. Over the past 25 years that I've served alongside Ron, I have reams of notes, meeting minutes, emails, and recollected conversations about a discipleship vision that would help people experience the rich life that God created them for. I have a shelf full of books that he led our staff through the years. He would be so excited about these books that would help us as a staff team and as a church execute that vision. Sometimes he would be so excited about that every book was in the best book, right? True confession, sometimes we and the staff looked at each other and said, oh, another book. He didn't just share his enthusiasm and passion with the staff. He did so with Dee, as he read a few pages of these books to her at night and told Dee, this is the best book ever, right? But that enthusiasm reflected how Ron was processing and refining the vision that God deposited in his spirit, and he was intent on doing it to the best of his ability. Some of you might link Pastor Ron with him envisioning this entire block that currently encases our current campus shortly after he arrived here in 1993. It is still breathtaking to look back and realize that his initial vision and quiet but tenacious perseverance has allowed us as a church, a small church by many standards, to purchase 8 properties and complete 3 expansion projects since his first walk around this block 25 years ago. Many of you might connect Pastor Ron with the often repeated and continually amazing story about garnering approval for variances for the expansion of our worship center in which we now sit, as he stood with Norman Hong in a neighborhood board meeting, a meeting in which the board members initially declined the 6 variances needed to continue the project. I think there's no better way to honor Ron than to use his own words in describing what happened at that neighborhood board. And this, I'm quoting Pastor Ron. Just before they were going to vote on each request individually, One of the board members asked a question. If we vote for these variances, would you be willing to lower the cross on the top of your building? At that point, I felt the nudge of the Holy Spirit. I put down the drawing I was holding, stepped in front of the board members, and said, in essence, no, we wouldn't agree to lower the cross. The cross represents what this community needs. There are broken people and broken families in our community. It is the message of the cross that can bring hope and healing to these people. We intend to raise the cross in this community. I ask you, men and women of the neighborhood board, to vote courageously tonight and help us raise the cross in this community. He continues on by saying, they proceeded to vote and passed each one of those six variances. When I left that evening, I heard one of the board members in the parking lot speaking to another member, saying he was an atheist and he didn't know even why he'd voted to give us approval. Folks from KCC in attendance at that meeting sensed God's power and a visible shift in the room after asking them to help us raise the cross. I believe the Lord was moving in the hearts of those people, as this has always been his vision. Proverbs 16:9 says, the mind of man plans his way, but the Lord directs his steps, unquote. Pastor Ruan's very words. The banner, the block, the cross, these are all visible parts of Pastor Ron's vision. But I'd like to share the vision that's behind the vision. Vision is often associated by what can be seen, an image, a diagram, a model, a building. My experiences with Pastor Ron and his vision is more related to what I heard than what I saw. It was reflected in the timbre of his voice, in the tones of care, respect, and compassion as he talked about people behind closed doors, even about those who disagreed with him or with whom he anticipated having difficult conversations. When he wrestled with these conversations, he would sometimes pace a small path of uncertainty as he balanced truth and grace, honesty and kindness. At times, the pacing gave way to him putting his feet up on that movable oblong table in his office. If you've been in his office, you know what table I'm referring to. The pacing or elevation of his feet settled his emotions and allowed God's grace to fill the crevices of his response. I can tell you that he spoke about people, about you, with care, respect, and compassion. What I heard through his voice was that the vision behind the cross on the worship center, the picture he saw beyond the block, the image beyond the words on this banner were people. People whom he genuinely had an affection for and whom he enjoyed. People who would be redeemed by the grace of God and would experience the rich life for whom Jesus gave his. Many of you know Pastor Ron from a platform, his platform ministry, but I'd like to share some examples from behind the scenes of his care for people. In our staff meetings, agenda items were often pictures of Colt and Callie, Brooks and Weston. He cared about his family, and they were part of our agenda on many occasions. He took me along as a new Christian in his early years of ministry to help a delightful but stubborn alcoholic as he spent hours upon hours helping him achieve sobriety. We sometimes took shifts on these sobriety watches. Why? Because he cared about Dave. He drove an older man with a debilitating Parkinson's disease to church almost every Friday night for years, joyfully and without fanfare, knowing that he would have to preach within a few minutes of helping him out of the car. Why? Because he cared about Roy. I watched him drop everything in his busy schedule on a warm summer day in July 2011 to sit with a family visiting from Oklahoma who lost their daughter in a motorcycle accident on the Pali Highway. He sat quietly with that family for hours in the ER room as they processed that tragedy. He had a full plate. He could have sent any one of us associate pastors to make the visit, but he didn't. He cared about that family. He spent years befriending an elementary-aged boy through Common Grace who is now a follower of Jesus and a meaningful part of our church family and worship team. Why? Because he cared about Jackson. And you saw Jackson on our worship team and doing very, very well. His real vision was people. As Norman read in his eulogy, it is likely that each of you are here at this service today because Ron has touched your life. He loved you, and you felt that. You heard it in his voice. He was genuinely interested in your story. Let me close with a last example of Ron's vision for people. It is an email that appeared in his inbox 12 days after he went home to be with Jesus. Let me read that email. From James Benitez, date November 24th, 2018, 8:04 a.m. Hawaii Standard Time. Subject, checking on you. Hey, Pastor, my name is Jimmy Benitez. We met in an airport, maybe Omaha, probably a year ago. I think I was probably wearing some Harley gear and you approached me and struck up a motorcycle conversation. I've been told that I can have this stereotype, scary biker look at times, and I think maybe you were actually wanting to see where I was at spiritually and if I knew Jesus. I let you know that I am a believer and we had a great conversation during which you informed me of your battle with cancer, which kind of stripped you of your ability to ride. Before you left, you gave me your card, which I keep on my desk and use it as a reminder to pray for this dude, who even though he is fighting for his life, is still concerned enough about the life of a stranger, a rough, angry-looking biker. It was a privilege to meet you, and I continue to pray for you. Remember, Jesus would have rode a Harley. If there are bikes in heaven, you'll ride again, and I'll ride with you, bro. Ride on and ride on. God bless you, my brother. Jimmy B. The vision behind the cross in the worship center, the picture he saw beyond the block, the image behind the words on this banner were people. People whom he genuinely had an affection for and enjoyed. People who would be redeemed by the grace of God and who would experience the rich life for whom Jesus gave his. That's you, and that's me. God bless you, Ron.
Morning, church family. My name is Afatia Thompson. My wife and our family, this is our home church. And I was asked by Dee and Rocky and the entire ohana of Pastor Ron Arnold to come and share in song. So I just want to say what an honor and privilege it is for me to be here at our home and to offer up a song to the glory of God. I had the privilege and the honor of seeing Pastor Ron at home, at his home, right down the road in Kaimuki. And it was just such a, we went there, my family and I, to hopefully lift his spirits and bless him. And it turned out that, as is usually the case, he ended up blessing us, me and my whole family, because just the picture of Christ's servant heart that came out from his example spoke so loudly to us, even in his last days here on earth, with whatever he was given, with his physical body and whatever he was allowed to do, he was still trying to reach others so that they could come to know our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So what a beautiful testament to him and to your family. All of you, welcome. To God be the glory now and forever. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and the life is worth living just because he lives. God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. To buy my pardon, an empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and the life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then when death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and the life is worth the living just because he lives. And life is worth the living just because he lives. And life is worth God be the glory.
I'm going to ask for another round of applause, but wait, a louder round of applause, a more powerful round of applause, because Jesus lives and so does Ron Arnold. He is alive! Wow! You know, the depth of our sadness is surpassed by the height of our respect and our love for Ron and for you, Dee. And there are reasons for us to cheer. If Ron could just send down a word from heaven right now, he would say, "Cheer up, I'm alive!" And this passage in Revelation begs for cheering. I mean, I'm going to read a couple phrases that are the final truth, the joyous fact. And after every phrase, can you come up with a hallelujah or a yes, Lord? You know, the Bible says all of God's promises are yes in Jesus. Isn't that right? Yes, right? Yes. And besides, you've been sitting for a while, so it'll be easier for us to cheer if you just stand up on your feet. If you wouldn't mind, please stand up. If you're able to stand up. And cheer with me. We saw him waste away from 195 pounds down to 116 pounds. And now he is completely alive and well in heaven. And listen to this. Every tear from Ron's eyes has been wiped away. There is no more death. This is Revelation chapter 21. There will be no mourning. Yes. No more crying. No more need for morphine, because no more pain. Ron is out of pain. He's well. Woo. The former things have passed away, and the one seated on the throne said, "Look, I am making all things new." Write this down. These words are trustworthy and true. All is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will freely give water from the life-giving spring. Those who emerge victorious will inherit these things. I will be their God, and they will be my sons and daughters. We're not mourning his death. We're celebrating his life. And this is a victory party. What do you say? Okay. Please sit down. I asked people for sound bites. And Howard Shima said, "Ron was one in a million." Mike Kawamoto said, "I didn't know him very well, but he was so genuine. He was the real deal." Jackson, where are you, Jackson? I said, "Jackson, if you could stand up here and say one thing about Ron, what would you say?" He would say, and Jackson said, "He raised me as his own." And I think we could all say that. We're the family. You're the mom. Ron was our dad, and he raised us as his own. He had a genius for bonding with people. Cal was talking all about that. Yes, he was adventurous. And golf was mentioned. The reason, I'll tell you the secret, the reason why Ron said it's not about the golf, it's about the people, is because he was such a lousy golfer. That guy had tremendous physical strength, and he could send that ball a long way, but you never knew which way that ball was going. And his sense of adventure, I mean, he was an intrepid explorer. And I would say that his golf swing took him to areas of the golf course that no one had ever seen before. But I boil my best friend and all that I knew about him down to one word, and that word is grace. He had the grace of God to forgive and restore me after failures in my marriage and my ministry. You remember Jerry, the elders at that time? You forgave me. Ron was always wanting and willing to forgive, accept, and love. And I experienced that. I joined the staff. Truly, I had no business being on a church staff. I had blown it, and I had made a mess of so much and hurt so many people. But, you know, I found grace. I found grace in this church and with Ron. And I got here just in time to see, I think, Ron's most shining moment. A woman came to our church with troubles and a really rugged life. Some of you will remember, I don't want to use her name, she was precious to many of us, but remember her arms? They were just puffy with parallel keloid scars from the dozens of times that she had tried to take her own life. Remember her wardrobe. Wasn't exactly a Sunday morning kind of wardrobe, but she fell in love with Jesus here in our church and was welcomed. Ron told me once, this is the church of the Mary Magdalenes. Jesus loves sinners, and our church loves sinners, and we can all be real in this place. We had a problem, though, because this beautiful and now clean and completely redeemed person volunteered to work in the Sunday school, and it created a crisis on our staff because someone said on the staff, I don't know if this is a good idea. The parents may see her and they might figure out what kind of a person she is, and maybe they might pull their kids out of Sunday school and go find another church. Well, Ron stood up in the middle of the staff meeting and said, is? You mean was. She is a newborn sister in Christ. She is as white as snow by his shed blood. She is a trophy of grace. And she's the reason why we exist as a church. She is who she is now because of Jesus. And I want you to put her out front so she can greet all the parents. Reach out her scarred arm and shake all their hands and throw her arms around everybody. And if they feel that they need to find a more respectable and safer church, well, that'll be up to them. But our church is all about grace. Amen? Amen. So, he made me promise to give people a chance to know God's grace through Jesus, even in this moment, if you haven't had that encounter with Christ. He always wore this bracelet, his gospel bracelet, and each of the colors symbolizes something crucial to our relationship with God. It starts with the gold color. That's heaven. We want to go there. In his last official sermon, he said, there's a party going on up there, and I'm going to save you all some seats. At Randy Hongo's recent celebration of his life and ministry, Yuko and I were sitting side by side, and Yuko leaned over to me, and she said, I'm not afraid to die now. Randy's there. I know Jesus is there. And now she would say, Ron's there. It's going to be wonderful. We want to go there. But there's a problem. The black bead says there's darkness in this world and in our lives. Why are things in such a mess? Why am I the way I am? Why is everything so broken? And that's sin and the despair that comes with it. It's a fact. It's also a fact that Jesus loves sinners. And as Cal said, and so did Ron. He loved me. The next bead is red. That's the shed blood of Jesus who died on that high cross for our sins, not his own, but for ours, so that we could be reconciled to God. If you accept the gift of salvation, the unbelievable, unthinkable gift that Jesus died for us. Listen to this. While we were still weak, at the right moment, Christ died for ungodly people. It isn't often that someone will die for a righteous person, though maybe someone might dare to die for a good person. But God shows his love for us because while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. So now that we have been made righteous by his blood, we can be even more certain that we will be saved from God's wrath through him. If we were reconciled to God through the death of his son while we were still enemies, now that we have been reconciled, how much more certain is it that we will be saved by his life? That's what Jesus did for us, and accepting that sacrifice on our behalf makes us as white as snow. Though your sins be as scarlet, yet they shall be as white as snow. The blue bead stands for baptism. If Ron Arnold baptized you, would you just please stand up where you are right now? If you got baptized by Ron, look. Stay up. If you know anybody that was ever baptized by Ron Arnold, stand up. If you ever saw a picture on the slide of somebody getting baptized by Ron Arnold, stand up. Hey, you guys in the overflow room, are you standing? Is everybody standing now? Let's give him a cheer. Wonderful. Okay, that's good, thank you. Because it comes down to the green bead about growth. Keep growing, keep going. Go all the way to golden heaven. There's a party going on up there, and he is saving seats for every one of us.
Was blind, but now I It's important I grab the right guitar because Ron gave this guitar to me. It was his. And he said he did one nursing home gig with it, and everybody was glad that was his last or something like that. But it's a sword, and I'm so grateful to have it. And I'd be honored if you would all stand with us. Thank you, Steve, Kaji. And we're gonna sing Raise the Cross together, a song that Ron co-wrote with Tony Tam Singh. It's a beautiful song. We're so grateful for it.
Lord, you've given all. Jesus, we've heard you call. You lived and died. You sacrificed your life. Lord, we celebrate. Jesus, we dedicate. We'll live our lives to hold your banner. It's our desire to spread abroad your faith.
Since we are family, and this is a great picture of the body of Christ, I want to offer a prayer. But with this prayer, I thought it'd be appropriate, if you feel comfortable, just putting your arm around the person next to you. If you want to hold hands, you could do that, whatever you're comfortable with. It's been a beautiful service. It's been a service where we could remember and honor Ron. A service where we could rejoice because Pastor Ron is with our Savior, where there's no more pain or mourning. And now we have to deal with the loss, and that's the hard part. We have this hope, and we know this hope, and we know where his eternity is, that he's with the Lord, but we've lost our beloved leader, our pastor. We've lost a great man. But there is hope. And so what I want to do is offer a prayer for all of us, that we would be able to work through the mourning, those difficult times, and pray a prayer of blessing. So if you would, allow me to pray. Father, as we hold one another, as we bond together as the body of Christ, as we mourn, as we are sad, as we are struggling, as we have questions, may your Holy Spirit move within us. May we find the comfort that only you can provide. May we have that peace that surpasses all understanding. God, may our eyes be lifted up to you. May the cross be the center. As the weeks and as the days and the months and as they go on, Lord, I pray for healing for everyone here who needs healing. I pray for this hurt, Father, to be mended. But God, I also pray that you continue to strengthen our faith, because we love you, Lord. And Lord, may your peace be on all of those. We pray this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
On behalf of all of us, we want to sincerely thank you for being here to honor our Father. You guys being here is a testimony to the person he is and the life of integrity he lived. We were blessed to have known him on a personal level. And we can assure you, he was as consistent with us as he was with each and every one of you.
We especially want to take a second to thank those of you who traveled from out of town. I may miss some here, but I'll do my best. Ron's brother, Jerry, from Nebraska. Dee's sister, Dorothy, and her daughter, Angela, from Nebraska. Ron's cousin, Leanna, and her husband, Skip, from Denver. Our Iranian brother, MJ Fala, from the DC area. His wife could not join us if she's pregnant, but is with us in spirit. And my parents always called him their Iranian son, so he's our brother. friends Neil and Robin Valatin from Klamath Falls, Oregon, came here. Tia Cooper from Seattle. Hal and Lana Jones from wherever they are in the world these days. Jack and Mahi Snell from the Big Island. Joel Littlefield from the Philippines, Brett and Susan Canelli from the Big Island. So thank you so much for coming. And Jay, you said if my dad could send a message, he would, and I received one. And this is not, I have my phone on airplane mode, so I was surprised when it buzzed during the service, but it's the verse of the day that I get every day. And the one that came in, it said, "No, in all things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us," Romans 8:37. So.
40 years ago, this church welcomed the four of us into the Ohana of KCC. The last year, the love of this church has been so abundant that for somebody who's never had a lack of words or anything to say, I want to tell the church family, thank you. Thank you for the outpouring of love for my mom, for my brother, for his wife, my nephews, myself, my wife and kids. You guys, KCC, everybody in here, exemplifies what it means to love Jesus. And you show it. From our family, guys, thank you. Thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. So as Pastor Jerry said at the beginning, if you haven't had a chance to greet the family, please feel free to come to the front after the service. For the rest of you, please join us for lunch. There's food served at the playground, which is at the back of the campus, and there's tables set up all around campus. And there are many stories that we wanted to share, couldn't share, didn't have time to share, so please do that over lunch. And just go in peace, and may the Lord bless you.